Hi! Today I will experience firsthand how dangerous are powerful laser pointers, I will lab test a lightsaber from a random store, see if it can blind a jet pilot, and what happens if you look inside. Any schoolboy can buy one of these on the internet, from 40 to 50 bucks for a device that makes you feel like Obi-Wan Kenobi. However, we can only assume the power output of one of these. Shop descriptions often have splash headlines, promises of power output similar to industrial lasers, and bad translations from Chinese. Different devices also have the same description photos. According to the seller, it is a 20-watt toy, but there are no markings on the side, apart a sticker stating Laser Class 3. What does it even mean? All devices that have lasers in them are divided on four main laser classes. The safest one is Class 1. It includes devices where the laser beam itself is never exposed, like printers or DVD players. This doesn't mean, however, that the lasers there are weak. Enthusiasts disassemble DVD players and make modifications to turn them into metal engravers. Class 1 only states the fact that, if used according to the user manual, such devices would never burn someone with a laser. Class 2 is made up from low-power devices with an exposed laser beam. Common presentation laser pointers, levels, rangefinders, and amateur project modules with less than 10 milliwatts of power output. Even if such beam hits a human eye, it won't do any damage, as the person would instinctively close his or her eyes, or just look away. Well, the next class, 3, poses a direct threat. Even the least powerful device of that class can cause partial loss of sight. So there must be a safety precaution notice and the beam source indicator. If a laser's power is less than 5 milliwatts, an accidental switch protection is recommended. If a laser's power is higher, then it's obligatory. That lightsaber of ours has a precaution notice sticker, but the pointer is aimed somewhere almost at the right angle at the lens. Small font suggests that accidental switch protection is not a must. But there's no credible information whatsoever about that laser's power. Measuring it with what I had at hand was no option, as the photoresistor won't do here. So if I go to my friend's lab.
I measured the power output of three different lasers using laboratory equipment from Coherent. That conventional laser pointer brought no surprises. Just 1.5 milliwatts, a bit higher than allowed by Class 2, but it is not hazardous. That tiny Chinese module was a little bit disappointing. The specifications state 5 milliwatts of output power, while we measured only 3.5 to 4 max. It is 20% weaker than advertised, but using it in a security alarm or as a cat toy, you won't see the difference. The lightsaber put us at a loss. Even barely charged, it put out up to 95 milliwatts. It means that the laser must be keylocked to prevent unauthorized use. There must be a laser beam indicator and a mechanical shutter to obstruct the beam in case of a switch malfunction. Basically, the safety precautions should be similar to this 10-watt bench. However, there is a two-position switch on the lightsaber, which is more dangerous than the laser pointer's single button. Let's pretend you switch it on and it fell on the floor. What would you do? Close your eyes and try to find it by touch?
The seller was kind enough to include these goggles in the box. They are cool, but they don't fit tight enough. And through these gaps, you can easily get blinded by some light spots. Compare them to Soviet protective goggles with leather inserts. I'm a real pilot.
What is 95 milliwatts of output power? Let's test.
For starters, the classic paper burning. It deals with the blackened piece of paper, no problem. In 10 cm range, the laser beam burns matches and melts through balloons in a matter of seconds.
Now just imagine how bad your eyes would feel if you looked directly in a beam like that. In reality, it is an extremely dangerous device in my hands. It is the green lasers that are bad at burning things through, but particularly good at burning retina.
The markings suggest wavelengths of 523 nanometers, which means that the manufacturer got greedy. Instead of an expensive green laser LED, the Chinese engineers used an IR pumping circuit. The radiation source, a conventional infrared laser, pumps an yttrium orthovanadate crystal, which radiates through a titanal potassium phosphate crystal. It doubles the frequency and outputs a visible green spectrum beam. If the manufacturer got greedy once more and didn't install IR filters, apart from a green beam, the device would output a powerful invisible infrared beam. Besides, the parasitic beam would be manifolds more powerful than the visible beam. Moreover, the beam spreads. How much? We'll see. Measuring those millimeters on a stand is a long and a dull process. So, I go outside. I find an approximate 100 meter range on a map. I stand on the high bridge and point the laser at the key. I don't aim it any higher to avoid accidentally blinding pedestrians or car drivers. The key is quite high, so even a random water reflection would probably hit a rock rather than somebody's eye. That range gives me a spot of about 30 centimeters. It is comparable to a human head. Let's see how much I can control the beam farther away. Hitting the water border at 400 meters seems possible, but upon reaching 800 meters, I wrap up with the experiment. At that range, even the slightest hand jitter may cause the laser to point at the driver's eyes level.
This experiment brought up a thought in my head. Public announcements about laser hooliganism have always seemed weird to me. Remember the fuss about offenders blinding landing pilots with laser pointers? I've always wondered how these snipers are able to hit a fast-going plane up there. So let's go to aerodrome to see.
Finding a pilot was no problem. Amateur aviation is romantics and enthusiast heaven. The difficult part was to make the flight director believe we were not insane. Blinding a pilot mid-flight on purpose, while your partner is sitting next to him, sounds weird, at least. But natural curiosity took over. A particular time period in the flight timetable was found, so that there would be nobody else above the aerodrome during the experiment. Half an hour more of discussing experiment's details, and we are good to go. The experiment is plain simple. The plane takes off, goes around the runway, that is called rectangular approach traffic, and after the fourth U-turn, it starts landing. At that point, I try to hit the cabin with the laser beam. Of course, I can hear what the pilot and the traffic controller say over the radio. If anything starts to go wrong, we stop the experiment at once. Of course, the pilot is wearing safety goggles. The plane drops to 10 meters and then goes for another lap. We will conduct the experiment twice. First I'll try to hit the plane from the side, and then from the front, standing at the edge of the runway. In the second case, the plane's angular velocity should be much less, and hitting the cabin with that laser should be easier. The laser's effect is evaluated by my partner, who sits beside the pilot and wears no protection. The first try confirmed my doubts. Hitting the plane that was going past me was too hard,
and that is under perfect conditions. The plane was going at a predetermined altitude, and its speed was twice slower than that of a normal plane. And I was standing on the ramp 100 meters away from the edge of the runway. Of course, I wouldn't have the opportunity to come so close in an international airport. Even the snow was playing into my hands. The laser had no aiming accessories, so I had to aim judging by the snowflakes caught in the beam. But the second experiment made me think. From the edge of the runway, the landing plane seemed almost still, like in those videos with the landing attempts on windy days. I used the laser's grip as my sights, and it was a success. Judging by the joyful swearing over the radio, I finally hit it. According to my partner, there was a visible sinking beam near the plane a few times, and one bright light spot, similar to a light spot from electric welding. The pilot didn't notice any of it, and asked us to let him have a pair of those safety goggles. It turned out that they made landmarks and gauges in the cabin look more apparent. However, there were no light spots on the recorded videos. We were not allowed to make a third flight. The aerodrome closed due to the weather conditions. Heavy snow and the upcoming dusk limited the visibility to less than 100 meters. So we tried to recreate the experiment on the ground. These conditions were really perfect, so finally the light spot appeared on the footage. It was nothing horrible, but if I were the pilot, it would make me uncomfortable. Landing is the hardest part of a flight. All the pilot's attention should be focused on controlling the plane, and that laser beam is capable of distracting the pilot from the controls. Sometimes those little things may cause disasters. As for me, I sure wouldn't buy such a laser pointer for my child. It is too powerful for a toy and capable of damaging eyes and doors. Using it as a lighter is inconvenient. It is way too big for a pocket. However, it can be useful for stargazers and astronomy enthusiasts, for pointing at constellations on a night sky.